Good evening, Southwest Florida, wherever you find yourself this evening. We are so delighted that you've tuned in to Connect. We have some wonderful guests from out of state and from right here in Southwest Florida. And we're going to hear in a little bit from Laurie Cardoza Moore, the founder and president of Proclaiming Justice to the Nations, and our friend from Southwest Florida. I'm going to let him pronounce his Jewish last name. I'll just say Steve for now, so I don't butcher it. And you definitely want to tune into this broadcast. It's very special, especially those of you that support Israel and what's coming on up with these elections. This is a very critical show. I want you to call your in-laws and your outlaws and encourage them to tune in, because this is a time you don't want to miss your moment and get informed, educated, inspired, and most of all, be connected to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Other than, well,
you're from right here in Southwest Florida, but a born-again Jew.
Absolutely.
From a real Jew. We'd like to welcome Steve. How do you say your middle name?
Actually, my middle name is Katariel, but that's not on there. But my last name is Ben-DeNoon, and typical among Jewish people to call themselves Ben, which means son, or son of DeNoon.
Well, it's wonderful to have you, and you've authored one book previously that our wonderful viewers can get on your website, Israel, Are They Still God's People? Refuting Israel's Enemies. And you recently about to release a brand new book called Yom Suf. And did I say it right?
Yom Suf.
Yom Suf.
Exactly.
Well, we're going to, I'm still working on my Hebrew and my English all at one time here. So we're getting ready to talk to you about that here in just a moment. But for our viewers that are, tuning in and maybe not written with you, the second book here, Yom Suf. Is that correct?
Yom Suf.
Okay.
Yes.
Help me, Jesus. But anyways, tell our viewers what inspired you to write this book. Why was it written, and a little bit about that?
Sure. Yom Suf, I actually introduced a synopsis of this story in the book, Israel, Are They Still God's People? And, of course, that being my first book is a little bit more of a challenge, because I write more from inspiration than I do from being a good author. But that book deals with replacement theology, the first one does. But while I was writing this book, I come across the movie Defiance, a Holocaust film about Tuvia Bielski. And Tuvia, during the war, when the Germans had invaded Belarusia, like not the only case we would have in the Holocaust, but he was intent on, one, surviving the Holocaust, but as well, he took and rescued over 1,000 Jews in the forest and hid them there. And they encamped in the forest, they moved about. They were also a partisan group as well during that time. And they would try to stage attacks against the Germans. He was working under the Russian partisan command. But when we were watching the movie, we seen it at the theater, me and my wife did, but we had rented the movie, brought it home, and while we were watching it, we get back to the part where they're in the Nalibach Forest, and there's no way out. The Germans have come in to try to put an end to all the partisan groups in that area. And while they're doing this, Tuvia is told by one, and in the movie they dramatize it a little bit, a little different than what really happened, but one of the partisans came up to Tuvia and said, there is a, of course they were in a forest with a lot of swamps, he said, but there is a swamp, there's an island in the middle of the swamp that where they were camped just meters away from, and he said, if we go there, we have a chance of surviving and the Germans not killing us. At that moment, of course, in the film, they show them, the Jews running down to the edge of this swamp. But it actually, in real life, Tuvia had lined them up like soldiers. And they looked as if they were going to go in the way of the Russian partisans. And ironically, Tuvia makes a sudden abrupt turn and has them turn and go down to the edge of the Sea of Reeds. And when the scene flashed on the big screen, when you're seeing it on we had a large screen TV anyway, you saw this scene of this huge group of Jews of the diaspora, and they're standing here at a sea of reeds. And of course, in Hebrew, Yom Suf means sea of reeds. We translate in the English Bible, you find that it's translated Red Sea. And it's been a big debate among scholars for years. Why is it Red Sea when we know it should be Reed Sea? And when I saw that event unfolding on the big screen, I knew, without a shadow of a doubt, just under a tremendous inspiration, that the Holy Spirit dropped down in the room, and I looked over my wife and I said, that is what Moses was speaking of. And she was just bewildered by the idea. What in the world are you talking about? She had no idea that chariot wheels had been discovered by Ron Wyatt and Vivica Pontian on the Gulf of Aqaba. The artifacts that were there were just unbelievable. So we know from that, and also the account of Solomon in 1 Kings, where he speaks of Yam Suf, and he had his naval fleet, which the ruins of that area, the city that he speaks of, Elam, is still there to this day, the rest of the world. And yet he compares the exodus of Egypt to this story. And you can look all through the Holocaust events that have taken place. There were many rescues of Jews, not just Tuvia Bielski and his group. There were others as well. But when we look at the Tuvia Bielski, and the book goes into much greater detail about this, everything about their story was just like that of the Exodus.
Share with us what your thoughts are as it relates to that. The rabbis can relate to this and give us some examples here in just a moment. Why you feel it's even something the rabbis can relate to.
Contrary to what God told him to speak to the rock that it brings forth its waters. Mm-hmm. And of course, Christian scholars know that this is referring to the fact that the Messiah, Moshiach ben David, would only be smitten once, according to what the scripture bore record. And this is why God was upset with him. Now, for Jews, though, the one thing that sticks out for us is when we look at this, it should have been an obvious sign when Jesus, when he was turned over to the Romans and they put him on this Roman cross, and the soldier that pierced his side, the scripture speaks of water coming out of his side. And if you think back in the scripture where he's with the woman at the well, and he says to her, if you knew it was talking to you, you would ask me for a drink, and I would give you living waters. Here he is standing there with this side, his side opened up. The water comes forth from his side. It's an open sign to us that he had to have been the rock. We know that God claimed to be the rock, but that water of life, we know that Hashem, or Yahweh, as it would be said, is the water of the waters of life to begin with. When his side is opened up, though, what's fascinating about this, I'll make it short, when Adam was first created in the Garden of Eden, in order to bring forth a bride, God taken from his side was opened up. And we hear the idea of a rib. It doesn't actually say a rib, but his side was open. And from the ish, the man, you'd say in English, ish, which is from the word in Hebrew, ish, and the divine letter yod in the middle of that makes the word ish, which shows us that Adam actually had the Spirit of God in him. And as we see at the Mount Sinai, the burning bush, it is the Aish, the fire, and it's Hashem, Yahweh, that speaks from the middle of that bush. So therefore, God created Adam with that spirit. He became a living soul, or la nefesh chayim,
sure.
For the soul was the life of Yahweh. And from that, he pulls his wife, and he creates his wife the same way. Isha, again, the fire, and the second letter in the divine name of God, now it's Isha. And so, at the fall in the garden, to make this simple, when the fall came, they lost that spirit. They lost the spirit of Almighty God, the Holy Spirit, as we would say today. And in the redemption process for Israel, that life of God has got to be restored back to us. And Jesus, like Adam, we would say was put into a deep sleep. In this case, death. He died.
Right.
And they say when you go to deep sleep, that's the closest thing to death under anesthesia. And from him, his side was opened up to release what was inside of him, which was nothing less than the Spirit of Almighty God coming from his side. And that's what the water, for us, we should have recognized that, yeah. That it was the Spirit of God coming from his side.
And, you know, another way to recognize it even is, you know, when that the fall happened in the garden, you know, also the very fact that the Bible says he died a spiritual death, but he still lived.
Yes.
So many more years. Was it 900 something years? So the life of God that was in him, you know. And so, right. in light of the world events that are happening now, how do you see that redemption process?
We are on the verge of it. This is why. And one thing, and I know Laurie is your next guest, and
yes.
I applaud her. My hat is off to the work that she does. The Jewish people. This is why we're in our homeland now. Mm. A lot of times, people look at the natural side of Israel and they say, how can this be a people of God? And they do the things that they do. I kind of say that we're doing things a little bit light compared to what God commanded us to do when he said to go in the land and kill all the inhabitants.
Right.
So we're more far more lenient in the days that we're living in now. But the point is, though, is we're there. And people should not look at the outward side of the children of Israel.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We are waiting. When we have Pesach, we set the glass of wine out for Elijah, and the door is opened up saying that we're ready to receive him. And we know that John came and forerun Jesus, but we do have a scriptural promise in Malachi that Elijah will still come again. For Jews, it would be as the first time of the coming of Elijah, other than when he was in flesh. So we're there to receive the Messiah. And it'll be the Zechariah fulfillment, where they will look upon him whom they have wounded, and they will say, where did you get these ones? He said, in the house of my friends. Mm-hmm. And if people ever notice that the scriptures in Zechariah, they separate according to family name, mm-hmm. not according to tribal order, which is perfect for the day we're living in. We don't know our tribal order that we belong in. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, when it says the house of David apart and the house of Nathan apart, that is this day. And so I would just say, don't look so much to the natural side of the things that yeah. we do and the mistakes that we're making as a nation. We're called there for redemption.
Yeah, amen.
And God will finish that.
So good. And, you know, in 2004, in light of world events, speaking of world events, you narrowly escaped a suicide bomber. I think they may have a picture of it. You know, I'm reminded of Psalms 91 when I think of you being an author and a historian. You know, God's purpose for you is not done. And so therefore, he protected you, as they can see some pictures there. Tell us real quick about that, and then we've got to go here in a minute. But,
sure.
Yeah.
And on September 22nd, 2004, I was living in Israel. I had spent a good portion of time over there to immerse in the language. Mm-hmm. But I lived near French Hill in a neighborhood called Gibat Hamiditah. And I always like to go in the early morning or in the evening time to go and pray. And on this particular day, I'm headed down to pray in a little forest that was near the house that I lived at. Mm-hmm. And as I'm coming down the road, not knowing at the same time that the Palestinians are dropping off an 18-year-old young woman on the street just opposite of me. Mm-hmm. And I'm on the telephone, and as I round the corner, there's two ways to get to where I like to pray at. One was down a steep hill, which I hated because it's rough on the shins. Mm-hmm. And the other way was the easy way, which is my preferred way, the path around the highway there, as you can see in the picture in the intersection. And that morning, of course, I intended to stay on the main road, and I find myself going down the hill, and a thought comes to my mind and says, you idiot, why are you going this way? You know you hate this way. And not knowing, you know, Satan is speaking in my mind, and so I turn around, I come back, I get back up on the main road, and I'm starting down. At that time, she's coming down the road with me, and the thought hits my mind again, says, if you go this way, you'll get to this pole where you always go, you'll turn your back to the winds, and you won't leave because you have one more phone call to make. And so I said to myself, fine, I'll go down the hill then. So I turn around, I go down the hill, and as I go down the hill, just as I get down to the hill, she blew herself up. Wow. And I was still parallel with her.
Wow.
But the hill dropped me behind the wall. There's a little concrete wall there. And the blast still like to knock me off my feet at that time. Mm-hmm. And then I realized that the footsteps of the righteous are the order of the Lord.
Oh, amen.
Yeah.
Tennessee, well.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you're not necessarily from there per se, but you reside there now.
That's right. I'm from South Florida.
South Florida. And it's great to have you here visiting us. Laurie Cardoza Moore, honored to have you.
Good to be back. Thank you, Paul.
And, you know, you are the founder and president of Proclaiming Justice to the Nations. And for those that maybe are not aware of who God has made you to be, you've served in so many realms of influence around the world. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and tell us a little bit about your background.
Well, Paul, as you know, we started PJTN back in 2002 as a result of the Lord calling me to run a resolution in Tennessee to support the state of Israel. And who would have thought that back then, 10 years ago, that God would be doing what he's doing now? And, you know, I just started out to honor him and to uphold his word. And I connected, you know, 6 months after 9/11, I realized that the battle that we were facing on 9/11 has been the battle that Israel's faced from her inception. And even before, it goes way back historically. Good. And so I heard the Lord say, I want you to take the resolution that Alabama just passed, and I want you to do it in Tennessee. And I said, okay, Lord. And since, of course, my background was in politics, and I had lobbied for Right to Life for many years in Tennessee, I said, okay, I can do this. And within 4 months, we had a resolution passed. And I never realized, even back then, how that resolution would impact even the state of Tennessee, even the economy, what we've what's happened to this country. Tennessee seems to be a little melting pot in the midst of all the chaos. We seem to be almost untouched economically, the housing industry, you know, and there's a lot, because Tennessee also is a major attraction, Middle Tennessee specifically, for radical Islamic extremists.
Sure is.
Which is really interesting, and we can talk about that a little bit later. But that's how I got started, just out of being obedient. And of course, I was a mother of five, as you know, homeschooling my children, minding my own business.
Yeah.
And the Lord says, oh no, we have to do some work. So. You know, here we are. Actually, Germany was a Judeo-Christian nation. There were a lot of Jews who lived side by side with Christians. But we don't connect the dots. We don't see how, at the time of the rise of the Nazis, they had a charismatic young leader who spoke so eloquently. And he wooed the people and swayed them. And he implemented a healthcare program in order to take over. That was one of the first things that Hitler did, to take over the country. Let's fast forward to the United States of America.
Yeah, how's that?
Today,
yeah.
America is considered a Christian nation, or a Judeo-Christian nation. It's the nation that sends the missionaries out to the four corners of the earth to bring the gospel message. It's the most educated nation. So why can't we see clearly that we're repeating the mistakes in the past? And we're doing it because we don't know our Bibles. We don't know our word. We're trying to pacify an enemy and try to build a relationship with an enemy who is not going to be pacified until they conquer us completely. And the battle starts in Israel. Israel is the front line of the battle. And if they can use the same rhetoric in Israel, here in the United States, just like they're winning in Israel, they've convinced the world that Israel has to give up the land, that the Palestinians have been displaced from the land and they deserve to have that territory back. No. The land was given to Israel. Joshua went and crossed the Jordan and took all 12 tribes. Yeah. Wouldn't let Manasseh, Gad, and Reuben, or Manasseh, Gad, and the third one over there, Reuben. Maybe it was Reuben. He would not allow them to go over there and stay while the other nine had to cross the Jordan and fight to gain their territory. He told them, all your fighting men have to come with us. Don't aggravate or frustrate your brother to have to fight this battle by himself. Your wives, your children, your livestock, they can stay east of the Jordan, but you and all your fighting men have to come and help. And we as Christians are sitting here on the western side of the Atlantic Ocean, oblivious. We don't look at what's happening in Israel. We don't feel the pain and the compassion for our Jewish brethren and understand, you know what? I can't be like that.
Yeah.
I have to help. I have to stand with my brethren as well.
Yeah. You know, your heart cries out for this, and I think, as you alluded to, every pastor, everyone listening, everyone watching, you know, if God is love, and that's the nature, and Jesus gave his life for every one of us,
right.
I think, you know, we are so self-indulgent, self-led, and instead of being spirit-led, we become so selfish and sense-led in the body of Christ, generally speaking.
Right.
And it has hindered us, because pride,
religion
and pride are cousins, you know? And it's hindered us to be able to see. And so I would say we have to continue to pray. We have to link arm in arms with organizations like Proclaiming Justice to the Nations. We're out there on the front lines. Go to their website. It's on the screen. Call that number on the screen. Those of you watching by web, you know, this is going to rebroadcast tonight at 8:30 p.m. You know, tell people about this wonderful ministry that's making a difference, not just in the Christian realm, but in the secular mainstream realm. One of the things that you've done is you have been a national voice in opposition to the building of the mosque at Ground Zero, as well as in Murfreesboro, Tennessee.
Correct.
You know, my good friend Eric Stackelbeck came down and did a thing on it and from CBN. But what is the latest update? What's going on, and how can people get involved and help?
PJTN presents a groundbreaking film from two-time Emmy Award-winning director Stan Moore. The Forgotten People, Christianity, and the Holocaust. The most important film every Christian must see.
PJTN, to me, is an organization that is a tip-of-the-spear type of organization. She's willing to do hard things, take hard positions on matters that some people want to back away from. I look at PJTN as a voice, a didactic voice, a teaching voice on the national stage and international stage for the cause of Israel and educating those regarding who should support her, why we should support her. And as a man of color in this world, partnering with an organization like PJTN is an easy yes, because they're educated, they're education oriented. They want to tell stories that few people want to approach, a few people find interesting, but they do, and they make it interesting.
At this critical juncture of history, when the threats to Israel and the Jewish people and Judeo-Christian civilization is so real and so urgent, we have no time to waste. We have to get this message, this urgent message, out, and we have to get it to people where they live. We have to get it to the movies, we have to get it to the videos, we have to get them on people's televisions. This is the work that Proclaiming Justice to the Nations is doing. This is the mission of Proclaiming Justice to the Nations. They are taking the message to the people. They are doing it in a way that people will see it and receive it. It is urgent work, it is holy work, and I am deeply grateful for it.
Laurie Cardoza Moore, and welcome to Focus on Israel.
It is so critically important for truth and justice to be spoken for by Christian media, because we follow the media so much, and that's why PJTN is so vitally important.
It is incredible. And really incredible that a Christian really cares about the Jews. Unfortunately, in my upbringing, I always considered Christians to be on the other side of the fence. Suddenly to notice that the person takes the time and the effort to undo this horrible mistake which has been done, and this injustice has been done, is so great and so remarkable that I really cannot more than thank her and be so happy about the fact that we are not supposed to be enemies anymore, but live together in peace and jointly. And I give most of the credit to Laurie, who made such a special effort to do this. I have shown the film to other Holocaust survivors, and they want to see it 2 and 3 times. You just can't believe it. For us, it is something unbelievable. Whatever she puts in the film is absolutely true and correct. And that's the way I live through it, and this is the way it really happened. The movie is really a masterpiece and should be seen by everybody in the world, and it would make it work much better than it is now. But I would really thank her for that, and it's great that the future for both of us will be wonderful, and thanks to her.